Good afternoon. Welcome to the Water Research Foundation webcast, Pilot Testing of Nitrate Treatment Processes with Minimal Brine Waste. My name is Mary Smith, and I'm a research manager with Water Research Foundation, and I'll be moderating this webcast today. This project was sponsored jointly by the City of Avondale, Arizona, whom we thank for their generous support, and the Water Research Foundation, and it was guided by three very thoughtful volunteer PAC members, Carolyn Russell, Carrie Meyer, and Laxman Devkota. I'll let our researchers describe the project further, but as the title implies, we evaluated several treatment processes with the goal of removing nitrates and minimizing brine waste. Presenting the project outcomes today are Ramesh Narasimhan and Ashish Agrawal of NCS Engineers. Ramesh is known for his strong background and outstanding reputation in the areas of water and wastewater design, planning, and construction management, as well as advanced water treatment research. And he's completed 12 Water Research Foundation, water reuse, and EPA-funded research projects valued at $6 million. Ramesh is a national leader in nitrate treatment evaluations, pilot studies, and full-scale design, and is familiar with the latest technologies, ion exchange resins, and innovative methods for waste brine handling and disposal. Our second presenter, Ashish Agrawal, has a profound understanding of water treatment chemistry, groundwater quality, advanced treatment processes, and GIS-based water modeling. He has worked as a lead design engineer for numerous treatment facilities and pilot studies for the reduction or removal of iron, arsenic, TDS, uranium, manganese, RO concentrate, and turbidity. He has also assisted the Arizona DEQ with more than 25 water system evaluation projects and 15 nitrate and arsenic treatment assessment projects. So before I hand over the controls, I have five housekeeping items for the audience. First, you can download the slides from your screen under Event Resources. Second, we'll have a Q&A session at the end of the presentation, but you can type in questions at any time during the webcast. We'll try to get to all your questions, but if we can't, we'll address them offline after the webcast. Number three, the recorded webcast will be available online after today. Number four, the report for this project was published just yesterday and is available now for public download. Just type 4578 into the search field of our website, and it should bring you right to it. And lastly, we appreciate your feedback. There's a very brief survey at the end of this session, and your completion of this will help us improve our future webcasts. So now we're going to open with a few comments from Cindy Blackmore, Public Works Director of the City of Avondale, which was the sponsoring utility. So Cindy, it's all yours.
Thank you. Well, good afternoon, everyone. I'm so glad to be here and so glad you could join us today. I want to start off by thanking everyone for their interest in this project. I believe you'll find the information presented today very interesting, informative, and beneficial as we move forward in our efforts to improve the technologies in the water and wastewater industries. When the opportunity to be a part of this project was presented to us, we were, of course, very excited. The city is always interested in exploring new and better ways to operate. Our current treatment processes are effective, and they allow us to deliver safe, reliable water to our customers. However, as we continue to grow, we will need to ensure our water is not only safe and reliable, but it's sustainable and affordable into the future as well. As you'll hear today, new technologies are being developed, and I believe we must continue to support these efforts. I'd be remiss if I didn't acknowledge all of our partners involved in the project, the Water Research Foundation and the Project Advisory Committee, of course, NCS Engineers for all their work, as well as Microbi Biotechnologies and Denora Water Technologies. In closing, I really want to praise the efforts of the team in the field that made this all happen. Planning and implementing a pilot study like this presents many challenges for them. There's so many factors to deal with. You have current operations and the operators out in the field, regulatory requirements to deal with, and not at all to be forgotten is the weather they were working in here in Arizona, and that can be quite challenging. They handled it all very professionally. No matter what challenge the team faced, they worked together and overcame it. So I want them all to know that we recognize and appreciate all the efforts that was tirelessly put into the project to ensure its success. So I look forward to continued progress in these technologies, and I hope the information you hear today will be helpful to all of you as we work together to move our industry forward. Thank you very much, and I'll turn it over to Ramesh and Ashish.
Thank you, Cindy. We'll get started here. We've got about 50-some-odd slides to get through, so some will go faster than others. Thank you to Water Research Foundation for this project opportunity and the City of Avondale for co-funding it, and the webcast here today, this opportunity as well. Getting right into it, the City of Avondale has a lot of water treatment needs for groundwater to remediate arsenic, nitrates. They also have some TDS concerns. So with these technologies, they've been generating a lot of brine historically, and the concern being an inland utility is disposal of the brine. So that was really the basis after the wellhead treatment master plan that was completed. That was the synergy for this project. So if we look at the options here that were feasible for groundwater treatment, with conventional ion exchange is being utilized here. It's been utilized with standard resin. There was a desire to look at nitrate selective resin to look at the performance differences to see if brine reduction could occur with the selective resin. And then also a couple of newer technologies using electrochemical denitrification supplied by Denora Water and reusing that brine. So rather than conventional ion exchange where you use the brine once and then have to dispose of it, reusing the brine several times, how effective that may be. And some of these were tested before, albeit not with a lot of success, before this project. And so we wanted to look at the recent developments to implement in this project. The last approach is biological nitrate treatment. There's three suppliers of that currently on the market. And for this pilot study, we evaluated those and went with the MBN2, the Microvi system. And as we get into it, we can discuss why and the reasons and the advantages of that system for drinking water. Hold on to this slide. The next one is a list of abbreviations. We'll be throwing these around. There's not a quiz at the end, but kind of hold on to this because it makes things shorter. So we'll be kind of like federal government here with a lot of acronyms that are important to the process. The main ones would be NSR, EBCT for the contact time in the vessel, BV for bed volumes, which is a capacity of treatment through an ion exchange system. Looking at the conventional ion exchange process, this would be a one-through regeneration, and it has several sequences, a forward cycle, a service cycle, then the system will go into backwash to remove accumulated particles. The backwash can be either treated on-site or disposed of the sewer. It generally doesn't pose too much of a disposal problem. But then the next two streams, the regeneration, where you're passing salt through the system to elute the accumulated nitrates, that has a very high TDS. That could be on the order of 40,000 to 50,000 milligrams per liter. So that's a very highly concentrated TDS. The salt is sodium chloride, but it gets converted to sodium sulfate through regen, which is a little bit heavier than your saturated sodium chloride. So that poses a disposal concern, and that's where the reuse of that salt solution looks attractive. Then you have two rinse streams, the slow rinse and the fast rinse, and these are passed, again, in a treatment mode to clean up the bed. The slow rinse typically is also could be around 10,000 milligrams per liter average TDS, and that also poses a disposal issue. The fast rinse can generally be handled with the backwash. It's much lower, well below 10,000, and that can be managed. So in summary, with conventional ion exchange, you have four waste streams. Two of them pose a disposal concern. And then in a conventional process, you could have either standard anion resin or nitrate selective resin, and both were tested in here. The standard resin is sulfate selective. Okay, this is widely used. It can remove nitrates, arsenic. It's very useful for uranium. However, it also removes sulfates preferentially. So when the sulfate concentration is high and it breaks through your run length, which is when your exchanger is done and needs to be regenerated, is terminated, and it has to be regenerated and put back into service. So so if your sulfates are high, and a rule of thumb is sulfate to nitrate ratio you know, if it gets to 10 to 1 in that range or higher, then the selective resin performs better. Okay, and so you, in which case the nitrates are removed preferentially to the sulfates in the selectivity sequence. So one of the intentions of this study was to compare these two resins in the pilot and compare the performance of sulfate selected and nitrate selected. The next strain is the NSR with the electrochemical destruction technology, and this was compared side by side with conventional ion exchange to ascertain the differences. So ion exchange was similar to conventional ion exchange, but on the back end you have the ECD unit, which consists of an electrochemical cell and then a catholyte and an analyte tank and chemical feed system. And what these units do is electrochemically denitrify the brine solution to off-gas the nitrates. And you see the equation there where we're passing the spent brine through the electrode. So it's an improved version. If you all know about on-site degeneration for hypochlorites and chlorine, the concept is similar with an off-gas. And so you'll see that you're off-gassing nitrogen with the nitrates in water. But the cell is of a different construction, electrodes and the reaction are different. So electrochemically, we're go ahead and converting those cells and the valence state to off-gas the nitrogen. Asish, you're going to talk about the schematic here next.
As we move from left to right on the process schematic, we see that well water is coming from the top, going through the exchanger, and then treated water is coming out. And then once the bed is exhausted, we pass sodium chloride, typically 12 to 14% solution through the bed, from the bottom of the bed to up. And then that brine solution basically takes out all the nitrogen which is absorbed by the resin. And this is the brine solution we put through the ECD unit for the regeneration. And then once the brine solution is regenerated, once all the nitrates are converted into nitrogen gas, we put back that brine solution back into the brine tank. By doing so, we lose a little bit of the strength of the salt. So typically, we have to refortify the reclaimed brine, but we don't need the similar amount of salt we typically need to make a fresh brine solution. We only need 1/10 of salt to refortify the solution. There is one more stream which is not shown in this schematic, is a spent or a scrub solution or a scrub step. Like typically an ion exchange process have 5 steps: service cycle, backwash cycle, regeneration cycle, slow rinse and fast rinse. But for NSR with ECD technology, there is one additional step that's called scrub step. What that step does, before the 14% solution is sent through the ion exchange vessel, 2% brine solution is sent through the ion exchange vessel. And this 2% solution takes all the carbonates, sulfates, and trace metals. Because electrochemical cell don't like sulfate carbonates, so this 2% solution takes out all the sulfate and carbonates before 14% solution is sent through the ion exchange resin.
So that creates an additional waste stream that needs to be managed. These are the pilot units. They're very similar in size to the full-scale units. And on the right side, the photograph shows the electrochemical cells that destroy the nitrogen and convert it to gas through the process. And then you see the trailer on the left side that housed the brine destruction unit. And all this testing was conducted at a groundwater facility called the cold water booster station site, where several wells feed into storage tanks and then combine and are pumped back out. And so this would be the site of a future treatment facility as the city bring more wells online. That's where the pilot testing was conducted. Okay, moving on to the last train. It's the biological MBN2 system. And here what we have is a biocatalyst that basically biologically denitrifies using microorganisms. The unique feature of this technology was the microorganisms are encapsulated in, you know, a synthetic bead form, basically. So That was the reason for preferring this over some of the other approaches that we showed earlier, was we don't have a biomass or sludge to handle or deal with. It's a very clean process for drinking water, so we don't have to worry about a lot of biomass or biomass sludge accumulation, sludge waste. And then if you're paranoid about drinking water like I am, you know, that gives you, you know, just a little bit on the process side that we don't have waste, biological sludge that we need to handle, and it also makes it, you know, much easier for the regulatory agencies for permitting. And so that encapsulated microorganism is what's converting the nitrates to nitrogen gas. And so it's in a, what we tested was in a fixed bed reactor. The enhanced design of this goes into more of a continuous stirred reactor device as well. Again, some of the unique features here, why it was interesting to Avondale, was no brine waste. So the reactor processed the nitrogen. Unlike both ion exchange technologies, you know, we're not recycling brine because we're not generating any brine. We may have an occasional backwash stream to the sewer disposal, but that would be about it. So the equipment here that we'll show following is the tanks, the bioreactor, aeration tank, and then post-filtration, again, just as an additional security measure to filter out any remaining biological matter that may be present. And then it needs a carbon source because it's groundwater, low in total organic carbon, so the bugs need a carbon source to sustain the reaction. And so we did have that and some micronutrients. And so one thing, just how this started, just this technology was being developed. We were doing something unrelated at Sunny Slope Water, and then I just noticed some tankage out the corner of my eye. So being curious, we went and looked at it and asked what it was and found out some information. And so now that was on the California water system there that now that's moving ahead to full scale. So that was about 2 years ago when the technology was in its infancy. And so the timing of that coincided with this tailored collaboration. So the idea was born to test it here. The pilot unit was about 8 to 10 gallons a minute. And then we had a variable EBCT from about 25 to 40 minutes through the process.
Again, as we move from left to right, well water is coming in, and we are feeding sodium bisulfite. That is to remove all the oxygen from the well water or from the raw water. Because this process, this biological denitrification happens in the anoxic condition, so we don't need oxygen more than or we need oxygen less than 1 milligram per liter. So after the bisulfite addition, we put the water into the storage tank. That's basically either the equalization tank or tank which is needed for the reaction for deoxygenation. After that, we add micro C solution, which is nothing but a carbon source. Once we add the carbon source, water is fed into the bioreactor and water moves from top to bottom up. Effluent comes from the top of the reactor, goes into the effluent tank, and then we that water goes through the aeration process to re-oxygenate the raw water. After that, we pass the water through the sand filter because there may be a little bit of turbidity, and after that, we do the post-chlorination. So that's pretty much ambient system.
And here we have the skid, which was about what, 5x6, and on the right side is the reactor tank, the biological reactor tank, the taller tank there, and then you have filtration on the left side. The black ones are the pre-deoxygenation tanks. So it's a fairly compact assembly with a integrated control panel that you see on the right side. A little bit of background on the city here before we start presenting the pilot results. The city has, they've been in the ion exchange and nitrate business for a long time, we've been privileged to be associated with it. And so there's two treatment sites now already, Garden Lakes and Gateway. And you can see they generate quite a bit of brine, 3,000 gallons of spent brine and 5,000 gallons of spent brine at each of these facilities. In the summer, typically they run much more than in the wintertime, but they're definitely used to meet the demand. And as such, the city is currently expanding one of these sites, the gateway site, to add an additional 1,700 gallons a minute. Now, this site is already utilizing conventional ion exchange, so the strategy here was to stick with the existing technology, and if just because these two technologies that were tested were somewhat in their infancy and not ready for full-scale implementation yet. The other site where the testing was considered is the cold water, where the innovative technologies are being considered. So right now the process is the spent brine is hauled for off-site disposal with a third-party contractor. And then obviously longer term, these costs are very significant, and brine disposal is a very key concern because the strategy for the city is groundwater, and then it's replenished by recharging their wastewater effluent. So it's a very sustainable system, and it relies on recharge of raw surface water, untreated, and wastewater effluent, but then it's pulled back out using recovery wells. However, those wells all need to be treated. So it's a very sustainable option. They're able to build up their water banks this way, but it does require some treatment and consequently, you know, brine generation and disposal. So the intent here was to be much more sustainable for the long run with their brine handling. So our objectives here were to look at two of these emerging nitrate treatment technologies that are more sustainable and economical, and you have the MBN2 and the ion exchange with the ECD. So how do we do this evaluation? We wanted to compare them against the conventional technologies. Not only cost was definitely a factor. Capital costs are one factor, but probably more importantly, the long-term O&M costs were very important. And then also the sustainability and the non-cost factors are very important. And that was moving towards developing a viable strategy for the CBS. That's not the network. That's the cold water booster station site. So this started at the cold water site last year. So it went from February to August. And so there was the PAC, which is the Project Advisory Committee, met in February. Just as we're kicking off testing, got to look at all the equipment on site, and then went ahead to about 5 months worth of testing with the City of Avondale staff. Leonard Scheid and his group were very instrumental in supporting this, and we learned a lot about the operations, and then also, you know, how it would operate in full scale when you run a pilot, and how you need to react to different process conditions was very important. And so there, we had four trains that we tested, the biological, the ECD, but then also standard resin, which are train two, and then train three, which is nitrate selective resin. And then obviously we also, in train four, the intent was to denitrify the brine, then reuse it, and keep going in cycles to see how well the brine could actually be reused. And so this is a very important part of the study to look at those interferences in the brine. Another important aspect was characterizing the waste and see what the waste handling costs would be for each of these processes. We have a primary stream and a residual stream. If we look at the data, we wanted to test wells with different water quality, so and also test other parameters. There's an interest here in obviously co-occurrence and co-removal of chromium. With chromium regulations and chromium being a regulated hazardous waste, chromium draws some attention in this area just because the aquifer seems to have a lot of it in it. There's a little bit of arsenic in here, so arsenic accumulation was also of interest. So if we go down to the nitrate, which is in the middle of the slide, you'll see the nitrates vary from 6.6 to 8.7 in the blended water up to 13.5 to 14. So the intent here is as their nitrates, they'd like to be below 8, but as they're going between 10 and 15, treatment will be needed here at the cold water site relatively soon to preserve those resources. Right now they're managing with blending, but moving ahead, that was the purpose of this study. So here is the first set of results from the MBN2 nitrate removal system, and there's three sets of data, phase 1, phase 2, and phase 3, which were the various well operating conditions. And the top set of graphs show the influent nitrate, So you can see we started in the 7 to 9 range. Phase 2, you know, was in the 14 to 15. And phase 3, what we wanted to do there was vary it to see how the system performed under varying conditions. So that was the, because the wells are going to be coming on and off, you know, based on the discretion and demands. So it was very important to ascertain in this study how the microbial technology responded to those changes in wells. We all know ion exchange is pretty steady static, and it can be resistant to that. And so we wanted to study those variations. You can see the results. Our treatment goal was 4. And you can see most of the results were below 2. In phase 2, there were some results that exceeded 4. And the reason for that was we had some process upsets. We're presenting all the data here in the research as researchers. And there were some issues with a broken tube in the chemical feed pump for the carbon solution. And so we ended up not feeding chemical during certain times that affected the effluent results. Also, sometimes the ratios we need to control is what we learned. We need to maintain a proper carbon to nitrogen ratio to remove nitrates. If we did that and we had no upsets, we were below 2 most of the time. So that was very important in what we found. And then here is a more detailed analysis of all the phase 1 data. The bottom level there is 2 milligram per liter as N. And you can see we had several below 1 and virtually all the data points except a couple of upsets where we had the process failures due to the chemical feed tubing were a little bit higher than 4. Moving into phase 2, we had higher nitrates coming in the 14 to 15 range. Here again on the bottom side, you see our treatment goal was below 4. And then, now Atish, we had on the right side, we had some biofouling. Is that why that was higher?
No, cracking.
Okay, cracking in the tube. All right, so the cracking in the tube where we couldn't feed the carbon solution was the reason you see the circle on the right side. So any upset was identified in, to this cracked tubing. Keep in mind, we have metering pumps running at about 110 degrees during this pilot study. So that's why we had some of the cracking to the tubes. And the last one was phase 3, where we varied the results, and we had up and down. And so you see the nitrate MCL of 10 at the top, and then the orange results at the bottom were below the treatment goal. The ones that are between 2 and 4 that you see, those again, we had some reduced deficiencies due to the process upsets that we described earlier. So our conclusions from this were, barring those, the cracked tubing and the process upset, we were reliably below 2 as long as we managed the proper feed of the carbon source and the micronutrients. So if we look at overall treated water summary, you saw chromium was a concern. So if we look at it, we did see a little bit of chromium reduction through the process. That's the first highlighted item, 8 to 5 and 9 to 7. Probably not significant enough to pose a concern in the waste characterization because the concentration factor is not that high. Nitrates on an average, 7.5 to 1.5 in phase 1, and then for the phase 2, 14 to 3.8. So this is when we look at the average parameters across the study. No impact, on sulfates. We wanted to study that as well, and some of the other parameters. So here's a summary. The other concern was the filter, and what we really found here is the filter, while it's it was a sand filter. While it was good for an extra barrier, the turbidities coming in weren't that high to begin with. Okay, they were always below 1. They were around 0.5 to 0.6. And so we got a little bit of removal, 0.3 to 0.4. And then all the samples were a negative for E. coli. So we wanted to test for bacteria parameters. Total coliform was present, as you would expect, before chlorination. However, when we ran them through the contact tank, which is also part of the process, the post-filtration chlorine contact basin, with 30 minutes was sufficient to give us negative total coliforms as well. With the spent backwash, we were getting fairly long filter runs. Every 2 to 3 days we backwashed. Those were all within the local limits for the sewer. So we checked all the local limits, so those could be discharged straight to the sewer. And so that was the strategy for handling the backwash from this treatment process. Occasionally, we did observe some sloughing that came onto the filter also, and that would happen sometimes when we had some aeration issues in the tank, and that would also put a load on the filter. But that would, again, only be during process upset, not a typical concern. So summary, this would really work particularly with a CSTR even without the filtration, but that's just an extra step to give the agencies and treatment plant operators just another extra barrier since this technology is fairly new to the water side of things. Just some of the operational considerations is the key issues for successful operation is having the micronutrients in the right dosage. And we're seeing that it's about 100 to 5 ratio, 100 parts of the micronutrients versus 5 parts from a nitrate SN. Breakpoint chlorination, to have that right amount in the post-chlorination contact tank. So regulating that feed so you do achieve that and hold that residual after breakpoint to about 1 was important. Having good aeration and then the other thing was continuous operation versus intermittent. Wells do operate intermittently, and our concern was being a biological. How does that impact startup each time? Again, what we found, if we had the right ratios intact, the acclimation time was fairly quick. It was a matter of 15 to 30 minutes that it achieved steady state. So if we contrast that to our wastewater experience, where it takes several days when you shut down a plant and bring it back with the biomass system, these bugs acclimated, you know, within minutes to achieve steady state. And next, we'll move into IX, ion exchange. And these are the parameters, our design parameters for the two trains of ion exchange. 10 gallons a minute per square foot is a pretty standard loading rate that we use. 5 gallon a minute on the backwash, 1.5 bed volumes for the backwash. Our regeneration loading rates were 2 GPM per square foot and about 2.2 bed volumes. These were fine-tuned a little bit, but all these were really driven by prior experience at Avondale facilities and other sites where these design parameters worked fairly well.
As we see the top left graph, the blue line that shows the top left curve shows the nitrate breakthrough curve. And then blue line shows a breakthrough curve for the standard resin. And then the purple line shows the breakthrough curve, nitrate breakthrough curve for the nitrate selective resin. So we can see that breakthrough for a standard resin occurred around 300 bed volume compared to for nitrate selective resin, it occurred at 500 bed volume because nitrate selective resin has much more affinity to attract nitrate compared to standard resin. And then if we see the bottom right curve, that's a sulfate breakthrough curve. And then if we see the black line, that shows the nitrate sulfate breakthrough for the nitrate selective resin. And then since nitrate selective resin doesn't attract sulfate, that's why sulfate breakthrough occurs much earlier compared to sulfate standard resin. Standard resin can attract sulfate for a very long time. And that's why if you see a breakthrough for sulfate occurred around 200 bed volume for nitrate selective resin and around 400 to 500 bed volume for standard resin. That's for phase one. And then moving on to phase two, during phase two, we were using well 25, which is the during this pilot, we used 3 different wells, well 15, 16, and 25, and well 25 is the highest nitrate well. It has nitrate around 14 milligrams per liter as N, and that's why you will see reduction in the bed volume. So again, top left curve shows nitrate breakthrough curve, and then earlier we were seeing breakthrough around 300 and 500 bed volumes, but for well 25, we saw breakthrough around 400 bed volumes for nitrate selective resin and maybe around 250 for the sulfate standard resin. And then going to phase three. During phase three, what we were doing, we were switching back and forth between the source water. So we had five runs in phase three. So for run one, three, and five, we used blended water, which is well 15, 16, and 25. And for run two and four, we used well 25 water, which is highest nitrate well water. So if we see run length for runs one, three, and five, again, top left shows nitrate breakthrough, and then we can see much longer run length for a nitrate breakthrough compared to self. And then again, for the self standard resin, run length was much smaller. Moving on to the next slide.
So here again, ion exchange, other parameters are very important. So you can see one of the things you saw, the chromium for the microbial system, we're going from 8 to about 7. So one of the things when we look at waste here is the chromium here is being removed very well. Okay, and so that's we don't want to concentrate the chromium too much because that could pose a disposal issue with your waste under RCRA. So that was an object of study. The arsenic, really not much removal there. And ion exchange for arsenic isn't really a very good tool, just having been involved with a lot of ion exchange projects. So the arsenic's not a concern, but the chromium in the waste is. And then when we, and that's a factor because when we reuse the brine, we want to get rid of that chromium so it doesn't accumulate either. So, and here it again in the nitrate selected, same kind of conclusion. Chromium's removed well. And not much with respect to with arsenic. Now, if we look at just the summary of the key characteristics, this is what would be going into our brine recycle. And so you see some of the issues that we have is the chromium in the spent brine. The limit is 5 milligram per liter. So is arsenic. Arsenic is well below the 5 milligram per liter RCRA threshold. But chromium can approach, and the nitrate selective is 4.2, so you need to manage the chromium carefully through these ion exchange processes. And then similarly, the backwash stream, there the backwash is fairly innocuous, well below the threshold, below all the local limits as far as arsenic, chromium, nitrates, and then even the TDS in the backwash is very low. So that's one thing. With these different streams, you saw the TDS was very high in the spent brine, so that's really not suitable at the city because it impacts their water reclamation activities since it's being recharged and reused. We're not allowed to elevate significantly the TDS to the wastewater plant, so the brine needs to be handled as a separate stream off-site versus going to the sewer versus backwash, you know, can go to the sewer because it doesn't really impact. It represents an opportunity to recover water, but doesn't negatively impact wastewater quality. Just some of the findings here, the nitrate leakage, and the term leakage in ion exchange is kind of the fixed level when you regenerate a column and you put it back in service. He goes, what's the effluent level start at? And that's a constant level. So the leakage level was a little bit higher. It's not a bad thing. It just means you're getting a steady state concentration coming off in. So it was less than 40% for nitrate selective lesson versus less than 20%. For also the ion exchange, a downflow regen worked well in this particular case, and really no other operational issues on conventional ion exchange. And it looked like, again, the nitrate selective resin for this source because of the high sulfate performed better. Now, that does vary. In fact, it even varies here in Avondale, well to well, but that does vary for each system. So just because the nitrate selective was good here, that doesn't mean, start ordering it for your system there. It's a site-specific situation. The last technology that we're going to present results on here was the NSR with the ECD. This one was just operated a little bit differently. The main thing is the service loading cycle was 16 gallons a minute per square foot on it, and this was a packaged ion exchange unit provided by Denora The other ion exchange units were supplied by NCS, and we ran them under our typical design criteria. The rest of the parameters were very similar.
Except that there was one additional step. Like typical ion exchange system have five steps. Over here, there was one additional step called weak scrub step, and that's the 2% brine solution which we pass through the resin before we pass 14% brine solution. And again, that 2% scrub solution takes out all the carbonate, sulfate, and trace metals because electrochemical cell, they cannot handle carbonate. So that's why we have to remove carbonate from the 14% brine solution.
So it's a little pre-scrub before you do the main regeneration so it doesn't foul the electrochemical cell.
Again, when we see these graphs, this is our train 4, which is nitrate selective resin. And even our train 3 was nitrate selective resin. So if we see the top left curve, those are nitrate breakthrough curves. And our breakthrough for this particular train was around 500 bed volumes, which is very similar to what we saw for train 3. Our breakthrough was around 500 bed volumes. And then, as I mentioned earlier, nitrate selective resin doesn't like sulfate. And that's why when we see the sulfate breakthrough curve, which is the bottom right, sulfate breakthrough occur much earlier. It's around 175 bed volume compared to nitrate breakthrough around 500 bed volume. These are phase 2 and phase 3 results. For NSR with ECD or for train 4, phase 2 and phase 3 were a little bit different compared to MBN2 system or conventional ion exchange. For ECD unit, like to have a highly concentrated brine with loaded with nitrate. More nitrate brine solution have it performs destruction better, and that's why we were using throughout. We were using well 25 throughout phase 2 and 3, and then we ran 8 or 9 runs during phase 2 and 3, but almost. After run 6, we lost our well 25 due to some misalignment in the casing, and we only had well 15 and 16 available. But for those for run 7, 8, and 9, we added nitrogen from outside into the raw water so that we can still have highly loaded nitrate brine solution. Results were very similar to our train 3. Our nitrate breakthrough was around 500 bed volumes or around 350 bed volume because, again, this is high nitrate well. And then if we see the sulfate breakthrough curve, sulfate breakthrough occurred much earlier. That's around 100 bed volume. So performance was pretty good and very similar to train 3.
And all these curves, keep in mind, it's very repeatable even though we were reusing the spent brine. So we got 8 reuses here, and the results on the top left are the different, but it all looks like the virgin breakthrough curves from the other trains we showed you earlier. So we're very, very pleased with the performance of the regeneration unit and how we could reuse the brine. And similarly here, chromium reduction was significant. Arsenic was not, so the ion exchange process performed very similarly to the baseline ion exchange unit. This graph, we talked about the scrub, but that's why we're putting up this table, and you can see the spent scrub. This is another waste stream that needs to be handled. Even though it's a small one, it's something that you need to pay attention to when you're looking at costs for the ion exchange system. And so you can see here we have a TDS of 14,000 in there, and some of the other parameters, that do get eliminated, the bicarbonate alkalinity, the sulfate, the stuff that will foul the resins, that's being removed in the scrub. So when you do have this, and there's a couple of strategies, it can be disposed of. We didn't recommend either one, or it could be blended back with the treated water is the other process proposed by the vendor as well. But this just represents another stream that needs to be handled that we have to account for. Backwash here, no problem with the backwash. All the limits are within local limits for the sewer discharge. And so the rinse streams, we talked about the different streams. Really, the brine needs to be handled with offsite disposal, but the rinse and the backwash can be disposed to the sewer. And so you're looking at some waste segregation with the ion exchange processes. Here's just some data in and out of the destruct unit. So we're able to reuse the brine, and the reason we could do that is you look at the top part of the graph is you have nitrates coming in the spent brine, 800 to 900 milligrams per liter, and going out, 100 to 200. And so therefore, you have that resin capacity available so that you can use this for regeneration and it doesn't cause an issue with regen. Because otherwise, when the nitrates get loaded, basically the regenerant will not function anymore because there's too much nitrates in it. And then here's some more of the similar data. Obviously, the nitrates in phase 2 and 3 were much higher. We're 1,000 to 1,400. But there again, we're able to manage that 200 to 300 milligrams per liter. So the denitrification and the destruct unit did their functioned as intended and removed the nitrogen and off-gassed it. So the process operational considered it's a pretty complicated technology with electrochemical denitrification. So obviously there's some skilled personnel there to operate it. But there really wasn't any issues observed as far as fouling and operation of the unit. It worked as intended. It's just compared to conventional ion exchange, it's definitely a more complicated process, we felt, in doing the pilot study. The next slide here is a summary of all the results across the different trains. So we can, if we go from top to bottom, it's different phases, and left to right is a different train. So if we look at it, the microbial system, which is train one, as achieving 73% in phase two, but other than that, 81 to 88% removal. Standard ion exchange, bed volumes treated is a good indicator. So you can see the nitrate breakthrough. Standard resin was around 300, 260 to 300. However, you look at the next column, the nitrate selective was closer to 500, 4, 5, and 600. And so you can see the advantages of the nitrate selective resin here, and then similarly 550 bed volumes for the ECD resin. So one of the conclusions here is the nitrate selective resin performs much better for this site, and with the microbial unit we achieved greater than 80% reduction. So with that information, one of the utilities like to do studies, but they need to get something out of them. It's not necessarily just research. We like research, as do all the participants here, I'm sure. But how does this affect them, and how can this be used to plan for this cold water site without generating excess brine? So cold water, you can see it's a big campus. The future flow ultimately is 8,300 gallons a minute. And so these flows are up for debate a little bit here, but plus or minus, we're good. And so we're in the 8,000 range. So the concern is as these, they're taking over a lot of agricultural wells and other wells in the region. So as the nitrates go up, we need to treat for this 8,300 gallons a minute moving ahead. So to deal with that, we looked at different conditions, which would need the most treatment. So we looked at all the possible combination, like a statistics tool, kind of a Monte Carlo simulation. And we came up of a condition when 15, 16, 22, and 25 run, we need to have 5,200 gallons a minute treated, and it's 9.7 milligram per liter. So that would require the most treatment. The other condition is the highest nitrate level, and that's 14.7 milligram per liter when well 25 runs alone. So we wanted to make sure that we were handling these worst case scenarios and costed the treatment system on that basis to meet a finished water goal less than 8. Okay, so that's with the 20% safety factor. And the cost on that, we'll walk through each one and it boils down to about 1,600 gallons a minute is the treatment condition. To meet those critical conditions, we need 1,600 gallons a minute of treatment ultimately, which is about 1.3 or 2.3 million gallons a day. So for the 2.3 cost, and this is not just the equipment cost, okay, so if the equipment vendors and other folks are on the line, this is total project delivered cost, and we're also carrying a 30% contingency in here. and then also engineering and CM of 20% as well. So it's about 53 cents per gallon, okay, for unit capital, or $6.2 million for alternative one, which is the microbial system. Now pay attention to this. The annual O&M for that is $234,000. Okay, so capital is one consideration, but so is the other one. For the conventional systems, what we did was we did some blending simulations to see what the blended water, because keep in mind, when you pilot test an ion exchange, you look at one column, but when you do a full-scale installation, this is going to have three columns. So these are the computer models that show the black lines in the middle show the blended concentration. So when you're running three vessels in parallel, you get a lower blend than a single vessel operating by itself. So we ran these simulations, and that allows you to get some additional bed volumes treated here. So that's what these graphs are. And for the conventional system, this is without a brine regeneration, just a single pass. It's $5.3 million, so about a million less than the microbial. However, the O&M went from $234,000 to $763,000, and they're getting a very good deal out here on their disposal also. Okay, they're able to dispose of it here. It's somewhere on the order of 15 to 18 cents a gallon for spent brine disposal, hauling and disposal. So that's at a great rate. The normal going rate for that is usually double, 30 to 35 cents. So even with that rate, we're running about $763,000. So although the capital is a million less, the payback's really short because of the O&M savings. And O&M's a recurring cost, which needs to be out of the maintenance budget for Avondale. So it's not just capital that's a concern. For the ECD system, same thing. The black line represents the blended concentration on a partial stream system, so we wanted to develop that. The other lines are the pilot testing results. So with that, this system, again, this technology likely in the future will come down, but right now the cost of the technology, because it's a newer technology, are still fairly expensive. So here, although the O&M was $331,000 because we were reusing the brine, much less than the $700,000 we were talking earlier. However, the capital here was fairly high. It was $10 million. Okay, so the capital was almost double, but the O&M payback was quick. So here we that was a valuable piece of information here. And again, as technologies evolve and improve, costs come down. But the data is here to support that. So in summary here, we have the cost comparison. You see the 20-year present worth. So you can see the capital range from 5 to 10, annual O&M 200,000 to 760. But the 20-year present worth is 9 million, 14 and 15. And so you can see the present worth costs and the O&M are significantly less with the microbial system. So there's a lot of interest. And that's driven by strictly brine disposal. That's what's driving those costs. We also looked at non-cost comparisons here, just operationally and different with being a newer technology. So this is a ranking scale. We gave points for all these categories, from operational complexity to sustainability, safety, reliability, footprint, and then how comfortable is the technology? How established is it? So on this one, the conventional ion exchange scored the highest, as you expect it would, because it's proven, it's been used here for 10 years, and they're comfortable with it, versus 19, versus 13 and 12. So just another piece in the decision-making process. There were no recommendations made in the study, just some conclusions and statements, and so here's the bigger conclusions was we had a nitrate removal for the MBN2 73 to 88%, nitrate selective resin outperformed conventional resin, and then the ECD unit where we recycled the brine and regenerated performed very similar to the conventional ion exchange, which is a major finding, particularly as the technology develops. There could be retrofit applications for conventional ion exchange systems. And then we got significant nitrate removal in the ECD of 76 to 92%. And through the demonstration, we reused the brine seven times, and we were on the eighth when the testing ceased at the end of the study. And then there's some additional research. We're looking at maybe taking a demonstration unit. It's done out of pilot, so the next step in these processes would be taking it to a larger scale demonstration to look at the effectiveness of these technologies. And then also the source water variability to see if there's some testing can be done at different locations with source waters with different levels of nitrates. And then with that, I think we have some time for a few questions on the webinar.
All right. Well, thank you, Ramesh. Thank you, Ashish. This question came up a few times. So for the biological process, what was the optimal carbon to nitrogen ratio or the range for that ratio?
So I think carbon to nitrogen to phosphorus, it's 100 is to 5 is to 1.
Okay. How about the electrochemical cell? Why does it not handle the carbonate and sulfate? Are there fouling issues on the membrane? And assuming that there are, would this be lower at a lower pH?
I think it's just the same as a hot water heater. I'll make that analogy. Okay, you've got, if you have very hard water with high carbonates and sulfates, you have a temperature issue here that those cells operate at, and they just cake onto the cells through that process.
Okay. How's the electron donor fed to the microbes?
The electron donor fed to the microbes, the micro-C. Is that on the biological? Can you clarify that?
That's what I'm assuming. Was that on the MBN2?
So what is it, the micro-C solution?
I think so.
Go ahead.
We can get back on that one.
Okay, get back, because that would make more sense on the
okay. Okay. Let me see. So let's go with this one. What's the difference between the upflow regeneration versus the downflow regeneration?
Go ahead.
I think in the upflow regeneration, we are having a brine solution coming from the bottom and then coming up. And on the downflow region, again, we are feeding brine from the top top down. I think one of the main difference is lately what has been found that when we do the upflow regeneration, the bottom portion of the resin is completely regenerated, and then it gives longer bed volume compared to the downflow region. So that's how industry is moving towards the upflow region, because again, bottom portion of the resin is much more regenerated, and then it gives longer run length.
Okay. So here's another one that we've had a couple of people ask similar questions. What was the empty bed contact time in the MBN2 reactor?
It was 25 to 40 minutes.
So someone thought that seemed a little bit long. Why is it so long?
I think a biological system, I think it takes longer reaction time. I mean, microbes take a little bit longer to digest the nitrate and convert into nitrogen gas compared to electrochemical cell.
Now keep in mind, this was also a fixed bed, and the CSTR module, that's around 15 to 20 minutes compared to this fixed bed reactor. That's one of the advantages in a stirred CSTR reactor. It would be a little bit shorter, or I would average about 20 minutes.
Okay. Another question about the MBN2. Can the biogrowth occur outside of the beads, and if not, why not? And also, what was the turbidity that required filtration?
The filtration wasn't really dictated by turbidity. It was more just an extra barrier. So the inlet turbidity off of the bioreactor was very low. It was around 0.6.
Okay.
I think the turbidity, the intent here was to take this and also go for regulatory approval. So we just filtered as a safety precaution, not necessarily because of extra sloughing or that we saw off of the bioreactor.
And generally speaking, regarding the biogrowth, since the microorganisms are encapsulated inside the bead, there are no microorganisms outside the bead. So all the biogrowth is generally not possible outside the bead, again, because the microorganisms are inside the bead. So generally speaking, not much biogrowth we are looking.
It's a microporous bead that they're encapsulated in. So we didn't see the biomass outside the bead.
Okay. What was the contact time in the ion exchange and in the ECD?
1.5 minutes for both the ion exchange units.
Okay. All righty. And let's see. Arsenic. The effluent had higher arsenic compared to the blended well water. Was there leaching occurring?
The arsenic, as far as sloughing, not that was significant. The arsenic, as far as effluent being much higher than the inlet, we didn't observe that.
Okay. I think we have time for one more question. So, is the nitrate selective resin more expensive than the standard ion exchange resin? And how would you determine which resin to be used?
Yeah, it's about 25% more, and I think it's going to be a function of the decision probably won't be cost-based, but it's going to be waste. If you're getting significantly more, if you're getting a 25% longer run length, that would justify the cost because your disposal waste brine volume is going to be much less. So that's going to be what the decision is based on.
Okay, great. Well, that's all we have time for today. Thank you, Ramesh and Ashish, and thank you for City of Avondale, for a great project and for this great webcast. Audience, please take a moment to complete our phenomenally long, brief, excuse me, it's only like 4 questions survey. So if you would do that, it would be very helpful to us. I want to thank you all for joining us today, and I hope you have a very pleasant afternoon.
Thank you.
Thank you.